Time now for Talking Points with Charlie Kirk, founder of Turning Point USA. Charlie, I want to continue our conversation about the Supreme Court here and the newly nominated Brett Kavanaugh. What was your first reaction when you found out it was Associate Justice Kavanaugh?
Sure. So he wasn't my first pick or my second pick, but he's still a great pick. And, you know, the more I learn about him and the more I see the left's outrage about him, the more I actually like him. You know, I was joking around. The atheists hate him. The feminists hate him. The leftists hate him. The Marxists hate him. All the people that I don't really have much respect for seem to really hate this guy. So it makes me like him a lot. He seems like a very outstanding individual. It was a safer pick than Barrett or Kethledge. That was probably more where I would have preferred the president go. But Kavanaugh is very strong on the Second Amendment, very strong on immigration issues. He has ruled properly basically on every issue. And there was a study done by PBS that showed, based on past rulings, where do these judges fall ideologically. And he was actually would have been rated even further to the right of Gorsuch at the time of nomination, which really surprised me. He's going to do a terrific job. He will get confirmed. You already have vocal support from some of the more difficult senators, such as McCain and Corker. They already said they're going to support him, which is a terrific sign. So look, it's a great nomination. It's going to put the court in the correct direction, one that is interpreting the Constitution as written, not as how you wish it to be. This is just another win for the greatest president of our generation.
I love your point that all the people we don't really like in America really needs less of are the ones who are opposed to this. Apparently, even the Hollywood foodie crowd is opposed to him. There's a new article out today lamenting the fact that when he was in college, he liked to eat bland food like cheese pizza. If that's the most you've got on this guy, you think about the kind of attacks the left are waging now. They don't like the name Brett. They think it's too frat boy. They don't like the way he ate when he was a college student. Doesn't that sort of tell us that there's very little out there, very few skeletons in this man's closet?
There's almost none. I mean, this guy has lived such a clean and clear-cut life. I mean, the attack is that he racked up a lot of debt watching baseball games. It's like, what? Are you kidding me? Like, this is really all that they have to attack this man? But look, they're trying to find a way to destroy his nomination because they know that he's going to rule properly on some of the biggest issues of our time, whether it be the travel ban, immigration, Second Amendment issues, guns, rule of law. I mean, and he's going to be very much in the mold of Scalia and Gorsuch. And guess what? This is not going to be the president's last Supreme Court nominee. And that's really, really exciting when you think about it. So he got Gorsuch in, he'll get Kavanaugh in, and then maybe we'll see who's next. But I think some of the other people on the list, I'd love to see Barrett on the court one day, if you ask me. I think she'd be a great addition. But this is a very exciting moment for America. And look, it shouldn't be, the Supreme Court should not be a politicized branch of government, but the left has made it one. They've made it one because they don't like the laws, therefore they want to interpret it as they see fit. And that's wrong and corrosive for our society.
Yeah, you make a really good point too, Charlie, that a lot of people wanted Barrett. I'm with you. I think she would have been my first choice. But when you stop and think about it the way Donald Trump has, it's really, really extremely likely, especially when Donald Trump wins a second term, it's extremely likely that Ruth Bader Ginsburg is not going to be around for 6.5 more years. It would be much harder to replace Ruth Ginsburg with a Brett Kavanaugh, a male justice. That's the perfect slot, it seems to me, for Mrs. Barrett if he gets that far.
That's right. And you have to factor in, when we approved Gorsuch, we had an extra Senate seat in Alabama that we have lost since. So the president's looking at the map, and he got some good advice, I'm sure, where they said, well, Mr. President, you can roll the dice, but you can't lose many senators for this seat. For Barrett, they said, we're going into a midterm election. Let's put Donnelly and Manchin and McCaskill and Tester and Hyde camp on the hot seat, make them either vote for the Supreme Court nominee or oppose it. Someone you can't oppose, like Kavanaugh, who's ruled properly, super smart, unbelievable case history. Or we could go to the more controversial side and they could come up with some excuse that individual's a fringe, right? So the president, I think the equivalent I would say is that, to use a football analogy, is it's before the half. You're the ball on your own 30-yard line. You know you're going to get the ball in the half. You know, the second half begins. You just kind of run the ball and you let the time run out. That's the Kavanaugh pick. Nothing wrong with that, by the way. You have the lead. You know, the Barrett pick would have been, let's play for a touchdown and, you know, let's, you could get intercepted, could get fumbled, you know, to use football analogies. But I think more importantly, it's an assured win in a political climate where the Democrats are opposing everything the president is doing. And they look like fools. They look like absolute fools. And that's a very important political tool the president has.
Well, if the worst thing you can say about Justice, the new Justice Kavanaugh, is that he is a strict constitutionalist, boy, it's amazing to me how the left, you brought up the left there, how the left is really, before even the announcement was made, we had that faux pas where a leftist organization released a standard talking point that had XXX in, right? Because it didn't matter who Donald Trump nominated. This was going to be the reaction there. To what degree do you think the liberal left has lost their mind on this? And with that in mind, the 800 million pound Republican elephant in the room, when you boil this down for the leftists, this is all about Roe versus Wade, isn't it?
Yeah, it's all about Roe versus Wade, which it amazes me how they can go from pretending to care about kids in cages at the southern border that was Obama's fault and then talking about how they want to separate kids from mothers' wombs. It's like very strange how you're able to make that shift so quickly. I thought you cared about kids. I guess you don't. For people might actually support abortion, there's no way you can actually defend what the court did for Roe versus Wade. It was imposing their own laws. It was passing their own laws. And secondly, it was ruled upon without any of the modern science or discovery that we have today. For example, when Roe versus Wade was decided, we did not know that every single baby in the womb had a unique code of DNA, never to be replicated again. It's only to be formed once at that very moment. It will never, ever, ever occur. That's a pretty amazing, you know, scientific discovery we didn't know. Number two, we did not know definitively when a heartbeat began in the womb. Best guesses were around 18 to 20 weeks back then. It's actually 6 weeks. We didn't know that when Roe versus Wade was decided. And third, which I think is most interesting, is that the woman that actually was in the Roe versus Wade case, she regrets it. She regrets ever bringing the case. She thought it was the worst thing that ever happened. And she's become she was a vocal spokesperson against it. And then finally, it was, I think this is the point that we need to make, is the collateral and carnage, the collateral damage and the carnage that ruling has really ensued. And the most dangerous place for a young person to be is in a mother's womb. And what does that say about a society if we are not able to protect those that simply, there's no way they can protect themselves. And I think that's why the left, for whatever reason, is doing everything they can to protect Roe versus Wade. It's very sick to me.
Yeah, I'm always amazed at the progressives' inability to see their own hypocrisy. You just mentioned a great example. They claim to be the party of the most vulnerable, and yet the most vulnerable, they are so cavalier about life in the womb. I think about Andrew Cuomo, right, who is now coming out in New York. He's already trying to strengthen laws so that if Roe versus Wade is eventually overturned, that a New York woman's right to an abortion remains in place, without even recognizing the fact that his own argument is making the case we're making. Roe versus Wade is bad constitutional law. Nine men, you want to talk about nine guys without all of the scientific data coming up with some obscure 14th Amendment argument about privacy to jam abortion rights into federal law, when in reality, people like Andrew Cuomo, I hate to point it out to him, would be much better off if there was no Roe versus Wade, so that states like New York can continue to abort away if that's what if the majority of the people in the state think they need to do.
Right. Well, he's such a moron. I mean, he tweets out, he's like, I'm going to appeal the decision. Like, who are you going to appeal it to? It's the Supreme Court. You can't appeal the Supreme Court. You're an idiot. He tweets out, he says, I'm going to appeal the decision if Roe versus Wade is overturned. What, are you going to go to the UN? I mean, seriously, this is like these guys. I don't know if they're actually thinking through this stuff, or they just sounds like it. Like, could you imagine a staff meeting for your viewers that don't know? Andrew Cuomo tweeted out. He said, "I'm going to appeal the decision of Roe versus Wade if it's overturned." But just so everyone is clear, there is no higher court in the Supreme Court. There's no appellate court. That's it. It's definitive. It's over. So could you imagine a staff meeting when they're about to send out that tweet? Oh, you know, it'd be really great, Governor, is if we say we're going to appeal it. Yeah, that makes a lot of sense. I want to say, like, well, no, there is no appeal process for the Supreme Court. Anyway, you're exactly right, but it's amazing to me. Cuomo's
I've contended for a long time that when Barack Obama won in 2008, as if the left had gotten their own pope. You think about all of the executive orders, all of the post-constitutional ways that illegal thing in many ways that Obama got his will imposed on the American people. I really think that progressives like Andrew Cuomo think that he'll be able to appeal to Barack Obama somehow over the Supreme Court. It really does show one of the great achievements of the Trump administration is to to pull us back from that kind of rule by diktat and give us again a national discourse on really important issues.
Totally. And, you know, I remember the Obama years, and they attacked Trump as being secretive and all this. This is the most transparent president in American history. I mean, he literally tweets in real time what he's thinking, what he's doing, what direction he's heading. With Obama, it would be days. We're like, where is he? What is he doing? So, oh, he's in Hawaii. Okay. But, you know, also Obama ruled by absolute executive fiat. You know, President Trump has been well within the rule of law, and all of his actions have been upheld by the Supreme Court. You look at the travel ban, it was upheld by the Supreme Court, so on and so forth. And Obama and the left, they have total disregard for the rule of law because they consider the rule of law to be an impediment for their radical leftist Marxist agenda. Never forget that. They think the rule of law is a speed bump. It is a barrier. It is an obstacle for them to instill what they believe to be the best thing for society, and that's wrong and corrosive.
You already hinted at strategy here, Charlie, and before you go, I want to ask you about this. You mentioned people like McCain and certain Republicans who are usually a thorn in the Republican side seem to be already lining up behind the new justice. But do you think there are any more Republicans? Can we count on maybe Susan Collins, or is that a lost cause? And do you think any Democrats will rally to this pick?
Yeah, I think certain Democrats such as Manchin, Donnelly, McCaskill, Heidkamp, Tester, hopefully will come on board. But look, I think Collins and Murkowski are going to have a tough time opposing him. I really do. I think that the support in the Republican Party is there. The support in their home states is there for confirming Kavanaugh. And I think he'll get confirmed just like Gorsuch by 54 or 55 votes. I really do.
Yeah, I think you're right as well. And so then we look forward to the retirement of Justice Ginsburg for really mind-blowing leftist meltdowns. Charlie, my friend, it's a great pleasure talking to you.
And also, here's a crazy thing. I'm not advocating for it, but imagine if President Trump started to pack the court and just said, I'm going to nominate 50 people, all conservatives. I'm not saying he should do it, but the left would if they were in his position.
Well, the left already brought it up. So if Donald Trump really wants to spook him, he should just threaten to do it and just watch the meltdown. It'd be a thing of beauty.
Should nominate 50 people. Could you imagine?
Charlie, it's great to see you. We'll talk to you next week. And that does it for us this week at the Dr. Duke Show. For Freedom Project, I'm Dr. Duke, and we will see you next time.